Welcome, Musketeers, Robbers, and Mayflies, to the 129th episode of an Unearthly Podcast, streaming live on the 28th of October, 2015, and featuring The Woman Who Lived by Catherine Trigano. I am Bill Sylvia, the Man in Black, and with me are Mad Matt Winchell.
Hello.
Randy Ronson McCulloch.
Always a pleasure.
Aaron Romeo Moon Burke.
Hello.
And Tim the Enchanter Sheridan.
Hey! Fun times!
Yep, sorry. Yep.
We have everybody tonight. I think it's been a little while since we had that.
Yes, we did. Yes.
Oh,
usually
which...
one or the other of us is gone. Well, not me, but...
Life happens.
Speaking of which, we didn't get a score from Tim last time.
Yeah, well, I was going to wait till after the news for that.
Oh.
Oh, I thought this was like, I thought this was like recording. This is a two-part episode.
It's not. This is the first non-two-parters. They were related episodes. Technically, this week's episode is a sequel to last week's episode. If you want to look at it that way.
Oh,
but they're two separate storylines with an interconnected character that starts in one and continues on in another, and I suspect will continue to be a reoccurring character in future seasons.
It's like the Dalek compared to the Long Game as compared to the Empty Child of Dr. Dances.
It's kind of like if in Classic Who they showed the Daleks and then they showed the Dalek invasion of Earth right after it.
Just wanted to give a brief shout out to Seamus McDamus. Hello, how are you? Thank you for joining in and chatting with us.
Oh, we got a chatter?
Yes, we do.
Well, yay, cool. We have a chatter.
Bye.
Okay, well...
And his name is Seamus. That's actually a pretty decent name.
It's a good Irish name, actually.
Yeah.
Are we more reviewing Scottish names name now?
It's a good Celtic name. There we go.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, let's move on to the news here. And our first piece of news is a happy birthday to Dr. Emeritus Matt Smith, who turned 33 today. Matt Smith, as we know, is the 11th Doctor, the immediate Doctor before the current one, Capaldi, and has left. He recently starred in Terminator Genisys and is now currently in post-production on two different movies, Pride and Prejudice and Zombies and Patient Zero.
Hmm.
He also is supposed to be in the Netflix series The Crown next year as Philip Mountbatten, the Duke of Edinburgh. Or of Edinburgh. Happy birthday, Matt.
Yeah.
Congratulations, Matt. Seems to be keeping plenty busy.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed.
So good on him.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to the overnight figures for The Woman Who Lived. We have 4.34 million viewers watched Doctor Who, The Woman Who Lived, according to unofficial overnight viewing figures. Doctor Who has an average share of 20% of the total TV audience, as was third for the day. Nice. Top for the day was Strictly Come Dancing, which had an average of 9.32 million watching. ITV had 6.55 million watching The X Factor, which was scheduled directly opposite Doctor Who. Casualty was pushed below 4 million with 3.95 million watching. Final ratings will be issued next week, which will be based on the exact transmission time for the episode and will include those who record it and watch it later.
So I guess the Great British Bake Off is done at this point because it's not beating the pants off of Doctor Who, and instead we've got Strictly Come Dancing and The X Factor, which has been annually topping Doctor Who. Once again, reality TV, goddammit.
Mm-hmm. Who watches this brainless stuff anyways?
Apparently everybody in the world.
Ugh.
I'll be honest, I would probably be curious to watch it too, you know? If I wasn't into science fiction or anything like that. All right, so let's move on to
If I wasn't into science fiction, I have no idea who the fuck I would be unless I was just watching horror movies all day.
No kidding, right?
You'd be boring, Bill. That's what you would be.
I would be watching American Horror Story on loop.
Yeah, right, you'd be Horror Boy through and through instead of sci-fi and Horror Boy.
On the other hand, being a sci-fi geek is a very expensive habit to support.
Once in a while, yes.
All right, so we've got the Australian overnight ratings for The Woman Who Lived and final ratings for Before the Flood. The Woman Who Lived has debuted in Australia, averaging 493,000 viewers in the five major capital cities. It was the highest rating ABC drama of the day and the 13th highest rating program of the day overall. These ratings do not include iView, regional, or time-shifted viewers. Meanwhile, including time-shifted viewers, Before the Flood averaged 660,000 consolidated viewers in the five major capital cities, with 152,000 extra viewers. It was the highest time-shifted program of the day. The second highest time-shifted program had an extra 134,000 viewers, and the 15th highest rating program of the day overall. These ratings do not include iView or regional viewers.
Hmm.
Oh, those Australian viewing numbers.
Yeah.
They're struggling. They're trying.
We'll try.
All on the coast and nothing in the middle.
At least they're getting it the same week this year.
Yeah, true.
All right, next bit.
Yep, so we've got The Woman Who Lived, the Appreciation Index, which has reached 81. Okay, the Appreciation Index, or AI, is a measure of how much the audience enjoyed the program. The score, out of 100, is compiled by a specially selected panel of around 5,000 people who go online and rate and comment on programs. With Sunday's overnight viewing figures now available, Doctor Who finished as the 37th most watched program of the week. Consolidated figures will be published next week.
That's actually interesting because this makes this the lowest rated episode of Doctor Who this season.
Yeah, which is a little odd.
And lower than any last season either.
Really? There wasn't an 81? Okay.
The lowest was an 82, which was Deep Breath and I think a couple of others. Deep Breath, Last Christmas.
Doctor Who typically runs in the 82 to 84 range, and wow. I can think of so many episodes last season that were worse than this one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
By far.
I mean, this, if you can, you're looking at this as a sequel episode, we have seen the trend this season that the second episode of every pairing is lower than the first. Although The Girl Who Died was, for whatever reason, lower than any of the others anyway. I'm not sure.
Do like the British population just not like Maisie Williams?
I don't know. It still strikes me as very odd.
Well, that's just interesting to know.
Considering the numbers and awards that Game of Thrones pulls in, you'd think she'd give it a bump, not a penalty.
No kidding,
and thus,
right?
And thus said, we managed to get through two episodes without her without doing a Game of Thrones bump reference. And we thought about it. We really thought about it.
True, but I'm pretty sure I called her Arya and mentioned the Starks several times throughout the summary last week.
My brain still thinks of her as Arya, so it's changing, but slowly. But then again, I still have the issue of calling new Spock Siler on occasion, so...
Yes, absolutely. I'm right with you.
Okay, so moving on, we have the chart placement for Before the Flood. This is the official placement. It has an official rating of 6.05 million viewers and is confirmed as the 21st most watched program of the week. Consolidated figures give the episode a share of 26.7% of the total TV audience. Over a quarter of UK viewers were watching Doctor Who and Before the Flood. This is, of course, issued by the Broadcasters Audience Research Board, or BARB. Includes all those who watch the program within 1 week of transmission. It does not include iPlayer. This year, I think we've mentioned it has reporting for the first time a 28-day figure, which gives an indication of how many people watch the program within 4 weeks of original transmission. So, Magician's Apprentice got a 28-day rating of 6.84 million viewers, 300,000 more than its initial 7-day figure. It's nice to see that their rating systems and placings are actually evolving with the times.
Slowly, yes.
I kind of wish the U.S. system would actually do the same. Hello, Nielsen families. Also, we have the official rating for The Girl Who Died. The Girl Who Died has an official consolidated rating of 6.56 million viewers. That Ooh. Indicates that it will finish at 19th on the chart. Again, to Lost to Strictly Come Dancing with 10.85.
Well, it's trying to push up that chart. It definitely is. Despite its appreciated appreciation rating, it seems to be still going up in views, so...
it's going up in views partially because of the changes in who's playing rugby and partially because of the changes in who's baking off.
True. And now the changes in who's dancing, I bet, will also figure...
Maybe.
Anyway, Doctor Who is still BBC's flagship series. It's the biggest, it is the most popular, and it is the most marketable.
And someone just dropped.
What? Who dropped? Oh, we lost to Tim. Oh. He'll be back.
Yeah.
He'll be back when he can.
Was his news piece next?
I do believe so, yes.
I'm going to have to steal his news piece. Unless someone else wants to take it.
I suppose I could, since I have to look at it next. Yeah. Up next, we have Zygon Publicity Shots, a roundup of publicity for the next episode coming up on Saturday. In the current series of Doctor Who, this particular episode is titled The Zygon Invasion. Little blurb here. The Zygons are a race of shape-shifting aliens have been living in the secret among us on Earth, unknown to the unseen. Unknown and unseen until now. Wow, I'm screwing this up royally.
We have Tim back.
You want to continue?
Oh, yes. My computer froze for a second. Invasion of the Zygons.
That's Zygons, Tim. Do not make me hurt you.
He's going to threaten another ball kick.
All right. So we have publicity photos for Invasion of the Zygons.
Let Zygons be Zygons.
Oh my god.
Yes. That's actually the name of a BBV special.
Bad Steven! I know that's your doing. Looking at any picture of Osgood, please notice what she is wearing on her collar.
Oh, I noticed that right away. Hey, I wasn't going to bring it up.
Oh, my.
Ah.
A gift
from
someone?
Well, she is wearing clothing based off a different doctor every time she appears.
Pretty much.
What was she wearing? Because I know she wore the scarf in the 50th.
And she wore a bow tie in... last season.
Okay.
Like a Matt Smith outfit-ish, or at least a bow tie, but she said bow ties are cool. It would be nice if she was wearing a cricket sweater instead of just a bland one.
Yeah, but my issue is the question mark lapels were so 80s and not really well-liked, not only by the audience, but by the doctors who wore them. They were glad to see them go, and so were we. So could they just remain in the past, please?
And she's a fangirl. I'm used to it.
So I'm wondering the Osgood in the photos, which who is she?
We don't know.
They still won't explain it.
That's why I'm wondering it.
They will never explain it. God damn it, Moffat.
I'm sorry, Tim. It's just driving me insane. I want to know how they're going to resolve this, considering we've seen one die.
Yes.
Is this going to be Zygon Osgood, or is this going to be?
I'm
going to
mention the trailer does mention something about someone getting a hold of the locations of all Zygons integrated into Earth.
Uh-huh.
So that might be a semi quasi confirmation of her being Zygon Osgood, or it may be completely unrelated.
And speaking of Zygon,
it would make sense if she was. But okay, go ahead, Tim.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Is the idea that the title of this upcoming episode, "The Invasion," wouldn't a better title be "Infiltration"?
Yeah, but they had the where they wanted to do that whole invasion inversion.
Mm-hmm.
Potato.
I don't know if infiltration is really right, because if we remember in their last appearance, they were integrated. So I don't know if they're really
Zygon integration.
I don't know if you can really infiltrate something you're already integrated into.
Zygon assimilation?
Man, this sounds like a Robert Ludlum novel.
I don't know, but
Is the woman that we're seeing in these photos in the bottom row next to Kate Stewart, is she the one from the series opener, or is she new?
She might be.
Let's see, the series opener. Where
we had the tech woman.
Yeah, on the unit staff.
Yeah.
I would have to actually go back and watch. There's a reason I leave these episodes on my DVR, so I can go back and review it and see if these are the same people.
It looks like her, but I'm not sure offhand.
It might be. Mind you, I haven't actually seen these photos until now, so I didn't notice her.
I suppose I should mention, even though it's absolute bollocks, Radio Times is looking at Clara's collar with a button shirt and asking if she's trying to imitate the Doctor in her dress, to which I give an emphatic no, she's dressing like a ruddy school teacher.
Huh.
Yep.
Yeah, they keep trying to milk way too much out of nothing.
Yep.
Yeah. I'm starting this season I've been getting a bit annoyed by Radio Times coverage. I don't know if you've noticed, we've been including less and less of their articles. And only when they're the only source do I actually remember to go back and add them in, because they include bullshit like that.
Yeah, pretty much. They're wasting our time.
Well, if somebody does an interview with the Radio Times, you better start including it, Bill, because sometimes they do get those.
Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, if there's an interview with Bites worth mentioning, yeah.
So other than that, I really don't see anything that's going to really tell us what's going on. There's one of Osgood hiding under a desk.
There's another one of her hiding behind. It looks like a file. Like a filing system.
It's a library. So
is she...
Osgood found a job as a librarian, and she found a map to a hidden treasure.
Now, what's interesting is in some of these... Okay, actually, yeah, looking at that. Those are definitely airplane windows, but the furniture and lighting is not very airplane-ish. I don't remember if that's what the inside of the plane in last season's finale looked like.
Probably.
I think it was.
Okay. It was kind of Air Force One-like.
Yeah, yeah, that's what this kind of looking vibes to send me to, so...
Uh-huh.
I don't think they had quite as many lights... So it has been upgraded a little bit, but it more or less seems to be the same interior.
Ah, oh God, and their second row far left is the Doctor doing his rock star thing again.
They're kind of milking that now, too.
There's a woman with a uniform that says New Mexico on the patch.
Where?
So that's interesting. The one, she's like a... She's a cop of some sort holding a pistol out. If you zoom in,
oh, down there.
The patch says truth or conscience, I think, New Mexico.
Truth or consequences.
Truth or consequences, there we go.
Yeah. I actually know that because it's the kayfabe home of Cactus Jack.
Gotcha.
From pro wrestling, from Truth or Consequences, New Mexico. So apparently they're going to be in the U.S. at some point in this episode.
Maybe.
Hmm. That makes sense if it's like a worldwide invasion.
Mm-hmm.
If they've sent these Zygons, you know, all over the world into hiding, it would make sense, yeah. I'm going to be interested to see. And actually, you see that same thing. Two pictures to the left with Kate Stewart.
Yeah,
and you can see
now.
You can actually see the consequences office. So part of this is taking place in a New Mexico police precinct, it looks like.
And it looks like that's the same filing system that Osgood is hiding behind in the next shot to the left.
Obviously, I suspect at some point they're going to contact the doctor about this, and they're going to wind up getting on the plane and investigating something in New Mexico that has to do with these Zygons.
It looks like that's also the same office where Osgood's hiding under the desk while texting, apparently.
It might be, yeah. That might be that they discovered this Zygon, you know, resistance cell, if you will. And we're in New Mexico investigating it when things, you know, went south.
Possibly, yeah.
Literally. Oh.
And we also have the doctor on a playground.
Mm-hmm.
Playground.
That seems to be a thing.
God, does he look old in that picture?
Well, at least he's not next to 8-year-old Clara this time.
Yeah, I mean, he looks like Palpatine old.
He's talking on a cell phone. How often do we see that?
Not that picture. Down and to the left.
I'm as far down and to the left as I can. Oh, it's the
same
picture.
No, just down and to the left from that picture.
It's from the same scene, but he has the...
I was looking all the way down and all the way to the left. So you're talking about compared to the top.
One down, yes. One to the left.
Well, it's one down, three to the right from the top.
What?
You found the picture, Bill. Let's move on.
God.
I'm so confused. Oh, God.
Speaking of where I live.
All right, moving on. Recently, The Underwater Menace was released with its found episodes in UK. Since then, it has appeared on iTunes, available for digital viewing. In addition to the story itself, which includes the found episodes and two reconstructions, it also includes a behind-the-scenes documentary. I believe we covered the special features when we covered the DVD itself. And is rounded off with a photo gallery. Let me take a look at the Amazon link. That's not the actual Amazon link. I hate when they actually do that, but
just as Amazon shop.
I'm just gonna make sure this is appearing in American viewing. Let's see.
Yeah. A copy. Amazon.
Oh, wait, this said iTunes, and I'm looking on Amazon because of that second link that was Amazon. So I'm just taking a look at what it looks like on iTunes, so I don't know if Matt's doing the same or not.
I'm looking at Amazon.
Gotcha.
The DVD's on sale, at least. They don't have an official cover, though.
I searched The Underwater Menace on iTunes.com, nothing comes up, so I'm wondering if this is UK only. I'm searching the UK website now.
I'm going to assume it probably is because BBC.
Mm-hmm.
It would be very strange for it to be streaming only in one place.
I don't have iTunes on this computer, so.
Mm-hmm. No, when I search when I search Apple UK for the Underwater Menace, there's still no results. So I'm a little curious about what they're talking about at this point. Okay, there is a link to it actually. Let me see what that link shows up. Okay, there is a link. That's £3.99 per episode. iTunes.apple.com/GB. I wonder now if I take out the /GB, what comes out? Hmm. All right, so it does look like the Apple.com/GB Great Britain link is the only one that it seems to be available from. I don't know if it works on American computers or not. I'm not very much an iTunes person.
Yeah, I couldn't tell you anything about it, trying to get it on iTunes.
There is also a competition being run by Doctor Who News while we're looking at the Underwater Menace. It is open to UK residents only through the 8th of November. It says, who was the director originally slated to make the Underwater Menace? If you want to enter, send your email to comp-fishy, F-I-S-H-Y, at drwhonews.net. With the subject, you're not turning me into a fish, along with, of course, your name, delivery address, and the fact that you heard of the competition here on an Unearthly Podcast. And that is to win the DVD. Again, that is UK residents only.
Yep. All right. Next. Mm-hmm. Next.
Sorry. Must have nudged my headset. Okay, so also to UK residents, if you are a collector, especially of figures, be prepared to open your wallets and head to Toys R Us. US residents, be prepared to check eBay and seethe in rage and anger.
Yeah.
Because Toys R Us in the UK is getting a new select collection of 11 figures, including a never-before-seen 8th Doctor figure. These are 5-inch figures instead of the normal 3.75, and are including, other than the 8th Doctor figure we mentioned, is Clara Oswald, Rose Tyler with K-9, Amy Pond in her police kissogram outfit, 3 separate 11th Doctor figures, one in a purple jacket, one donning a cowboy hat, and one in his classic pose. 4 versions of the current and 12th Doctor are also part of the lineup. The main difference here is that there's a choice of the figure in white, black, purple, or polka dot shirt.
That is Peter Capaldi. They're supposed to be Peter Capaldi in polka dots?
Yes.
That does not look like him.
Where?
In the in the image on the left.
The
what's that? 5 rows down, something like that.
It doesn't look angry enough.
Mm. Maybe they got the eyebrows wrong.
I think they got the eyebrows wrong, and the hair isn't quite as big.
Also, of course, is the 8th Doctor in his Night of the Doctor outfit. The 4 3.75 inch Wave 4 figures will also be available brand new. Al Dewar, the product development director, commented, "The collector series is really special. The fans have been requesting a return to the 5.5 inch format for a long time, and in producing this collection, I feel we have brought to them exactly what they have been demanding. The most exciting part for me, however, is the creation of the 8th Doctor figure, which is often seen as a missing piece for the true Doctor Who collector."
Yay.
Mike Coogan, the marketing and e-commerce director for Toys R Us firmer, commented, "Toys R Us has a particular affinity with the Doctor Who fan, and each year we like to bring them something that they could not get anywhere else. This new series is exceptional and I believe one of the most comprehensive collector series to date. It will be an instant hit with all collectors, except those in the U.S. God damn it.
I think my favorites here are the 8th Doctor with the chalice and the 12th Doctor with the moon spiders.
I quite like the Mac Smith figure, actually.
Which one?
It's a pretty decent representation. The regular one without the cowboy hat.
I like Clara in the plaid skirt.
Yeah, that was actually a pretty good one for her, too.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, the new ways they piss me off. Come on, Toys R Us. Doctor Who's a global franchise now. Let's see some America action now.
I don't like the fact that there's like four different versions of Peter Capaldi, which the only difference between them is the color of the shirt.
Oh, that does seem to be That does seem to be the major difference in his wardrobe.
Like, yeah. Sometimes he has an angry face, sometimes he has a guitar, you know, switch it up. Sometimes he has sunglasses.
Although, that polka dot shirt, I expect, is supposed to be his holy shirt.
I noticed his hair is getting longer this season.
Well, that goes with the whole rock star look.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. True.
Yeah, they could have probably put him in the hoodie. Yeah. Unless they really didn't have enough notice for the molding and everything.
I don't know what's up with that.
Like,
I think these are based off of Series 8 at this point.
Mostly. Because... I mean, there is the Dalek that I think is from the season opener.
Actually, I don't think that was in the season opener. That's a third Doctor Dalek is what that is.
With the tubes in its head that
that's
from Into the Dalek.
Oh, okay. At first I thought that those were, you know, the melted Daleks attacking. No. That's why I thought it was from this season until I zoomed in.
No, that's
an Into the Dalek, and I suspect that was a command carrier Dalek.
So these were probably commissioned before this season came out.
When they had access
to any information.
Yeah, it takes them about a year to get a figurine run.
Yeah, they could have put them in the caretaker outfit, though.
That would have been nice.
Yeah, jumpsuit.
Speaking of last season, there's no Michelle Gomez in this collection. I mean, I know she just recently had some figures come out. I don't know if it was the same manufacturer or not.
I believe it probably is, because this company is the company that does the exclusive Doctor Who figures. They're the official licensor. Mm-hmm. This is Character Options. They're the ones that do it.
A couple of them that look worth it, but that 12th Doctor mold, it needs an update.
Yeah.
That doesn't quite look like Capaldi at all.
His eyebrows are at the wrong angle. That's the main issue.
The hair isn't quite right.
I think they're not big enough either.
It just doesn't look like
him. They didn't focus on the fact that they're attack eyebrows.
So the main selling point. I'm actually picturing the 12th Doctor holding this. I'm like, this figure is defective. Look at these eyebrows. They look nothing like me.
A big problem is that a lot of these figures that they're showing, too, are also the 3.75. And 3.75-inch figures are 80s-grade Star Wars figures. 80s-grade G.I. Joes. So there's not enough space on the plastic to get an actual detailed face.
Mm-hmm. On those smaller ones, yeah.
The 5-inch figures, they have no excuse.
Yeah, they don't have an excuse. This is a regular figure size. They could do better.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, moving on.
Yep.
Yes.
Well, I'm sorry to burst your bubble, Randy. I know you've been, you know, hoping and praying for the time when Moffat will be leaving Doctor Who, but that will not be for next season. No, Moffat is sticking around.
Freaking damn it.
I do just want to add, before we go too far into this, I apologize if you were already planning to say it, but this is apparently according to what a BBC source told The Mirror, so that's 2 degrees of questionable, but I honestly believe it's probably true, which is why I figured it was worth including.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Moffat and Capaldi are returning for Doctor Who Season 10. Two new reports this week appeared to confirm that Doctor Who exec Stephen Moffat and Peter Capaldi will both be back next year, and this is according to Cultbox, the UK website. Peter Capaldi joined the show as the 12th Doctor in 2013, and his second season is currently airing on BBC One. Season 10 will be Stephen Moffat's 6th season as showrunner. Speaking to Observer.com, Moffat commented, "I'm just embarking on the new season, and it's terrifying. I have to make it all all that again.
Yeah,
he has to make all that again. Revealing that he's most proud of what he's most proud of on Doctor Who recently, he added, "We got some new writers in who I thought were really great. Jamie Matheson and Peter Harness. And thank God for voices of new people writing. I love that. Having new writers this year, Sarah Dollard, Kat Tregenna."
Tregenna.
So it's always good getting people who are new to the show. So it sounds like he's not had to do maybe too much of the writing, so maybe he's not going to get burnt out so quickly on it, but yeah.
Mind you, with a half season under our belts watching, I actually think this is probably Moffat's best work that he's done since he started.
It's also notable that if you count two-parters as a single story, Moffat is only writing two stories solo this season, which is by far the least he's ever had to write. Plus, of course, the ones that he's editing and, you know, have a co-writing credit on, which is part of the script editor's job anyway.
Yeah, I'm wondering if he's actually learned it's probably best to sit back and supervise. Instead of being so proactive like he was in previous seasons.
Because, yeah, the more proactive he gets, the sloppier the writing seems to get.
Yeah, so sloppier the editing seems to get.
That too.
All right, and we should also include that the Mirror reported this weekend that Peter Capaldi has agreed to stay on for at least one more season. He has apparently agreed to a new one-year deal with a further one-year option. A BBC source is quoted as saying, "Peter has made it clear he is happy playing the Doctor for as long as the BBC and viewers want him. Peter is keen to complete 3 years playing the Doctor to round off his storylines that will take us into the end of next year. After that, who knows?"
Well, with the fact that he's coming up on his third year, it may be time to start talking again about who's going to be the next Doctor.
Not quite yet. Because all of the Doctors up till now have done 3 years and change.
True.
I mean, technically, the three seasons of Matt Smith ran...
4 years.
4 years. David Tennant's three seasons lasted four years.
Yeah.
But, so we're only at his halfway mark if we're using that as a measuring stick.
Depending on whether or not we go back to continuously getting full seasons per year or whether we break it up again.
Yeah.
Either way, there's the possibility that by the time they're filming the next Christmas special, they'll need a doctor for him to regenerate into.
I doubt it. I doubt Capaldi will step down until, 2014, 2015, 16. I believe 2017 is where we're going to be looking at seeing another doctor.
Mm-hmm. Most likely.
Whether it's three seasons and change, or he actually is the first doctor of New Who to do four solid seasons. I think, because he doesn't look like he's slowing down yet.
No, sure. Not yet.
Well, you don't pick up a guitar just to slow down.
Very
true.
you
pick it up to die of a drug overdose.
Wow. Dark.
That's dark, yeah.
That would be an interesting Christmas special. The Doctor hosts a rock concert. What? The Doctor is regenerating in the toilet.
Oh, God.
I want to bring us on to the next story.
Yeah.
That also might mean Capaldi might be Doctor forever because he'd become the Doctor equivalent of Keith Richards.
Mm-hmm.
Yay for K-9.
Yep. Okay.
Well, sorry, is that mine?
There's a second piece there.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it ain't easy quitting the blue box, and Jenna Coleman's plea to Stephen Moffat about leaving Doctor Who has made, The Radio Times, has made the Radio Times emotional. They're an emotional wreck, I tell you. So yeah.
The actual quote is in the third paragraph, if that's what you're looking for.
Yep.
The third paragraph?
Yeah.
Third paragraph in the actual article.
Yeah. He told the audience, Stephen Moffat is doing his best not to rub salt into the wound. He told the audience at London's MCM Comic-Con, Jenna actually asked me, could you just not have the new one come in while I'm still there?
Yeah. That's
sad.
So that tells us that unless he's just saying it, you know, telling us about it so he can be an extra dick, it probably tells us that we will not see the new companion until we see Clara's actual departure episode, which is presumably but not definitely in the finale.
Yep. Mm. Yeah, and that, of course, that the article does mention where that came from and the fact that Coleman was actually on set for at least one episode with Amy and Rory still there.
Mm-hmm.
And so she got to feel like it was being the person replacing, didn't want to do it on the other end of it.
Right. So I'm kind of getting the impression, especially considering who else is going to be in the Christmas special, that this is going to be a classic RTD companion switch where the companion leaves in the finale, we have a special with somebody else, and then the new companion comes in the following season.
Yeah.
Either that or we get introduced to the new companion during the Christmas special. We have no idea. We've had no news on the Christmas special.
Well, we've had, I think, only the news that River Song's appearing in it. Which means, I guess, this one, the doctor's wife won't allow to think that she's a guy until they meet a year or so later, like what happened with Clara.
So, in other words, this is going to be another Christmas special I hate.
Hmm. Quite possibly.
Oh, joy.
Joy to the world. Is
And then we hang you.
Like a Christmas stocking?
Something like that, Tim. Something like that.
Over the chimney and you fill me with oranges and candy?
Keep it up, keep it up, Tim, and you're going to have to start making gallows jokes.
They're not oranges. Although the word is on the tip of my tongue.
Satsumas.
Thank you. I almost said tangerines, but I remember that they're not the same. They just look the same.
Yes. Satsumas. Well, alright, are we moving on?
Yes.
I'm kind of now picturing Tim roasting on a spit with a satsuma shoved in his mouth.
Oh, I'm so glad I bring joy to people. And speaking of bringing joy to people, dog lovers will love this news. K-9, the world's most famous robot dog, traverses the dimensions of space and time to become the latest robot star of the big screen. Yes, there's going to be a K-9 movie! Woohoo!
Woo!
And it's called Time Quake! And it's been written by one of K-9's original creators, Bob Baker, who also co-wrote the Wallace and Gromit film, Curse of the Were-Rabbit.
That was the good one, wasn't it?
Yep.
One of the really good ones,
And it features the classic Doctor Who villain, Omega.
Omega?
Omega? Yes.
Really?
Omega?
Holy shit!
I wonder if it's going to reference the recent, following the same continuity as the recent Bernice Summerfield audio featuring Omega.
I can't tell you. It looks like these pictures, the continuity they're following is the K-9 TV series.
using the same logos. Right, well, what I mean is in terms of if it'll actually contradict it or if it'll reference anything, you know, it wouldn't be explicit. It would be a sort of implicit, quiet thing, you know, allowing them to exist in the same universe, if anything. It wouldn't be a straight-up obvious thing. Mm-hmm. Sort of like I believe you mentioned that there were things that gave the idea that this is K-9 Mark I without them actually coming out and saying it.
I'm looking at the picture of K-9, and I'm getting a Star Wars type feel to his design.
That is, I think, with some modifications, the version of K-9 that appeared in the K-9 TV series. He kind of regenerated from the classic K-9 into this new hover dog form. Although this one looks like it has higher that they redid the model with more details.
Yeah.
Because
I remember the other one being a little more streamlined and bland.
Well, remember we were waiting for an announcement this week about the K-9 television series.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like this is it, and this is a continuation of the television series.
And it's linking up with Doctor Who again, so that'd be interesting.
Yep. I actually find this slightly annoying in the fact that K-9 makes it to the big movie screen before the Doctor does in continuity.
Affirmative. Tail wag.
Now, they mentioned that the film is scheduled for 2017, which is K-9's 40th birthday. If it is going to be on his birthday, he first appeared in a serial that ran from 1 October to 22 October of 1977. So
The Invisible Enemy.
Yes. I'm hoping that it's on the actual day of whichever episode first featured him, but we'll have to see.
He's pretty much in there right from the first episode.
So it'll be the 1st of October.
It might be the second episode.
Okay.
Because I think the first one happened on Titan, and everything else happens on the Vial space station, which is where we meet Professor Marius and his robotic dog, K-9.
So judging by the fact that movies are normally released on a Thursday night and their official release day is the Friday, I'm going to say give a tentative date for this as October 7th. Oh, no, that's 2017, not 2018. I'm looking at the wrong calendar. A tentative date probably of October 6th as a release date, but that's not actually stated yet.
Yeah, I'm hoping it's late enough that this doesn't get buried by summer spectaculars.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't want K-9 to go up against, like, the MCU.
Yeah, pretty much.
Because it would get buried.
When is Rogue One coming out?
Yeah.
That's December 2016. What about Episode 8?
That won't be for another couple of years.
That's May 26th of 2017. So that's before the summer blockbusters, so that's not a concern.
Yeah.
Wait, Episode 8 is coming out 6 months after?
6 months after the first anthology film, yes.
Wow, I can hear George Lucas spinning from here. He's not even in his grave, he's just spinning.
He span and knocked over a giant cookie jar of R2-D2.
You spin me.
I'm checking
right
to see if the second anthology film has a release date yet, and
I can hear him
May of 2018, so it's still out of the way. It's not even in the same place.
I can hear him frothing, going, "No, no, 3 years apart. They have to be 3 years apart." It's tradition. You don't mess with tradition. Of course, nobody's listening to him, but he's still saying it.
Well, who cares as long as the next couple of movies are going to be really good.
Goodbye, my wallet. I liked you.
At least they're giving us 6 months. I can actually save up for a movie by that point.
Yes, but I have to get that and the MCU. And freaking X-Men Apocalypse, as crappy as Apocalypse looks. I still have to see it.
Oh, that looks shite.
Tim, want to read the competition?
Oh, yes, all right. So,
yeah, going back on topic.
To be in with a chance to win a copy of the book, The Essential Book of K-9, courtesy of the author, simply answer the following question. In the television series, who was the original creator of K-9?
And if you were listening, I mentioned it.
Mm-hmm.
Please send your answers along with your name, address, and where you heard about the competition, news site, news app, other website, etc., to...
So, an unearthly podcast.
To comp-k9essential at doctorwhonews.net with the subject affirmative.
Affirmative.
The competition is open worldwide! And closing date, November 8th, 2015. Only one entry per household will be accepted.
All right. Let's move on to our news.
Moving past K-9 in spin-offs, We one of our former doctors, David Tennant, has done quite a bit of voice acting work. He appeared in Star Wars, The Clone Wars, and recently, as Rand can attest to in my flabbergasted state last night, he's apparently one of the main cast of the new season of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, essentially playing a robotic form of the Doctor named the Fugitoid, who's actually has a human professor name, which I, for some reason, closed that window. So, of course, the Turtles call him Professor. Beyond that, he is the 10th Doctor. He is scripted as the 10th Doctor, and I'm just waiting for him to say what or Alon Z. Hopefully they don't go that far.
Oh, dear, dear. How the heck did Hasbro miss hiring him as a voice actor for My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic? Do you realize how many bronies would have geeked out if their character Time Turner, a.k.a. Doctor Who's, actually spoke with David Tennant's voice?
Yes. I think they just gave him a generic British voice.
Pretty much.
Actually, his voice changed in every appearance from what I read.
So does his appearance a little bit, too.
I thought he only spoke in one of his appearances. He might have had,
I think two or three.
He was probably background in most of them as compared to the one where, like, all the background characters came to the foreground.
But
his appearance changed, so it's entirely possible he regenerated from episode to episode.
But I the first time I saw him, he had pretty much a generic American voice, not even a British one. I was a little annoyed.
Yeah.
And by the way, I'm not a brony. I just watched the episodes with him in it.
Gotcha. Now, why is it, and hopefully Matt hasn't already spoiled this with the visuals, but why is it that I'm talking about David Tennant's voice acting career? Well, not long ago, we covered a rumor, and Big Finish is finally able to come out now that it's confirmed and say for sure, yes, David Tennant and Catherine Tate are confirmed for the 10th Doctor adventures in Big Finish audio drama.
This is pretty much it. This blows the door open on Big Finish's freeze out on New Who stuff. This is the first New Who Doctor to actually go to Big Finish.
Yes, we've had stories featuring New Who Doctors, both in Destiny of the Doctor and in more recent news in the Churchill years and things of that nature. But this is the first time a new Who Doctor actor is going to be portraying that character. Of course, David Tennant has had a history with Big Finish, but not as the Doctor.
So this should be interesting.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the team-up of Tennant and Tate is a really wonderful, wonderful team up. Those two play very well off of each other. It's a real kind of Laurel and Hardy situation.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Although which is which changes at every given moment.
Pretty much.
So what's being released what's been announced, I should say, is a series of three adventures. They are available separately and as a limited edition box set. The series starts in May of 2016, and I believe is being released. Actually, it may not be monthly. It may be all at once. They're all being released in May of 2016. It starts with Technophobia by Matt Fitton, which is in a London setting slightly in the future where mankind is gradually losing its ability to use everyday technology. Could there be an evil force at work? Then moves on to The Time Reaver by Jenny T. Colgan, where the Doctor and Donna arrive on Calibris, an entirely mechanical planet. Catch, hitch, fuel, fix, buy pretty much any kind of transportation in existence. It's also a world full of scoundrels where a deadly black market has opened up a device known as the Time Reaver. And then finally, In Death and the Queen by James Goss. Donna is swept along in a fairy tale romance and meets the man of her dreams in the beautiful land of Gauritania. What can possibly go wrong? And why has the Doctor never heard of Gauritania?
All right. Yeah, we really don't have time to comment on these, so move on to the next article. I mean, this is huge news, but we are approaching our hour mark.
Are close to our edge.
Yeah.
I was looking for the post that Nick Briggs made about this, but since there's not really time to read it anyway, I'm just going to quickly summarize that this was not the announcement of this was not intentionally delayed, but when the rumor came out, they were still under negotiations. And had Briggs actually answered the request for a quote, it might have scuppered the entire negotiation. Now, our final bit of spinoff information is that the BBC has announced the information on the Sherlock Christmas special, which I think has been announced every year for about 3 years, but there's finally a name and a date. And that is the 1st of January 2016. Will be Sherlock, The Abominable Bride, which will be available in theaters through Fathom Events, and otherwise will be revealed as a television special. There is a trailer to it. I have not watched it yet, and we really don't have time to discuss it much anyway, but that's definitely something for Sherlock fans to look up, and as there is information on it now.
All right. So that is pretty much taking us to the top of the hour, and that's going to take us to our 5-minute challenge. Do we have a volunteer?
Me.
That's right. Ooh, Tim volunteered last time, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Let me get the stopwatch.
Okay.
Stopwatch. Okay. Are you ready, Tim?
No, but I'll go anyway.
Okay, start in 3, 2, 1, go.
So the Doctor is bopping around England at the time of Oliver Cromwell when he comes across a highway robbery in progress, and the Doctor has this weird device that sort of looks like Egon's PKE meter. and he notices that the meter is beeping a lot when he gets near the trunk that's at the back of the carriage, and the highway robber is like, "Dude, get out of here, get lost, this is my robbery." And the Doctor says, "Oh, why can't we be friends? We can share, that's what robbers do." And while they're arguing, the carriage drives off, and the Doctor and the robber are like both stuck there looking at each other like, "Well, this could have gone better." And the Doctor says, "Hey, why don't you show your face? I show my face, and I'm ugly." And then the robber takes off the mask, and it's, surprise, it's Isilda from the last episode, the girl who was made immortal. It turns out she's been living for 800 years, you know, and she has a whole mansion of library books that where she's kept a detailed written record of her whole life. And so she's saying, "Dude, I've lived so long that my memories have, you know, sort of faded away. So I don't even remember that life I lived. And now I'm stuck here. And so thanks for nothing, Doctor." And then she says, "Hey, Doctor, can I go with you?" The Doctor says, "No, you cannot go with me." "But why not?" "Because we're trying to milk this." And so it turns out that Isilda, who calls herself Lady Me, because she's all about me, has a secret friend that she's helping out who hangs out in the woods. And she's also looking for a hidden treasure. And the Doctor says, "Oh, well, I have this PKE meter. Why don't we help each other?" And they do. And they find this hidden gem. It's the gem of Hades, which protects the spirits of the dead, supposedly. But it turns out that Lady Me is in cahoots with this guy who looks like Lion-O. And it turns out that the gem is powered by death. So a person needs to die in order for it to work. And Lady Mi thinks that they're going to use the gem to open up a portal and she's going to escape Earth because the level of technology at Earth at the time is too slow for her and she feels she's trapped on a slow-moving planet. And they meet a guy named Sam or Silly Sam singing who tries to rob them, but he gets captured and is going to be hung, and the Lady Mia stabs him with the gem, and he's dying, and so that opens up a portal, and all the lion people are invading, and Lady Mi remembers she's a soldier now, and she says, "Hey, this is a bad thing I've done. What the fudge? I feel bad. And doctor, we have to do something." And the doctor says, "Hey, do you still have that other microchip thing that I used to make you immortal? So we can use that to stop that guy from dying, and if he doesn't die, then the portal is closed." So they say, "Yeah, let's do that!" So that they slap it on his forehead, and the evil lion person gets killed, saying, "Brothers, spare me now!" And the guy who was going to be killed lives, and he starts a prosperous career as the world's first stand-up comedian. And and we flash forward to the doctor and Isildur in a bar saying, "Well, you're still not taking me with you." And the doctor says, "No, we both have our own paths to go." And the doctor says, and the soldier says, "Well, I got my eye on you." And the doctor says, "I got my eye on you." And it's very awkward and tension, and you know, it's like what will the future hold? And then we cut to the doctor practicing his guitar, and Clara shows up for the first time in the episode, says, "Hey, that girl got an A and she gave a selfie." And so the doctor says, "I don't want to look at the selfie." And Clara says, "Oh, okay." And the doctor says, "Oh, all right, you talked me into it." So he looks at the selfie, and then he zooms in, and Isildur is there. So we know that Isildur has lived to the present day. And I think that's where the credits ran.
All right, stopping there then. Despite your rambling, you only ran over a little bit. You got it in 6 minutes and 24 seconds.
Ooh. Yay!
All right, Tim, also, would you like to give a rating retroactive for the girl who died last week, since you forgot to include one?
Retroactive rating for the girl who died is, I'm giving it 5 stars.
I think that's what we predicted with your comments.
Yeah.
5.0 will move the rating up to a 4.1, which will tie it with Before the Flood.
Yay.
Golf claps, everyone.
Golf claps.
All right.
Okay.
So, let's move on now to our likes and dislikes. Starting with you, Matt, what did you like overall about this episode?
Oh, I usually talk so much about effects. There's nothing else in general that I really like. I like that we see some of the after effects and how the doctor can help reshape someone back to where they should be. This is as an overall message. Like, he technically did abandon her here, but the overall idea is that he's here now and he's going to help her bring her back to where she probably should be. and remind her what's actually really important, and that's the things going on around her and the people she knows, essentially. Including this little village. Because in the end, she may want to get off the planet, and she might want to go out and see the stars, the universe, and everything, but she doesn't want to be at the cost of other people around her.
Alright. Bill?
I like that they addressed the idea of the effects of immortality on the human brain. Captain Jack is kind of, you know, becomes a more mysterious figure, so we really don't get to see, you know, what he does, what he knows, what he doesn't know, what he feels, what he doesn't as often. Whereas here, you know, we get a kind of in-depth thing, and we can really see, you know, the effects of living well beyond what her brain was intended to retain the information for and how that's affected her personally.
Also, the thing about Captain Jack is that he's also an alien. He probably has better memory than...
He is not an alien.
He's just a human
from the future.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Still seems to have their retention. Anyway.
Tim?
I like how this episode... I think my other thing was already taken in how it deals with the effects of immortality on human beings. But another thing I like was that how it deals with the actual consequences of the Doctor's actions in sort of like a not overly negative but not overly positive light, too. Like, usually, like, whenever we deal with what the Doctor, the effect the Doctor has had, it's really negative, as in Genesis of the Daleks. Or, it's sort of glossed over. But this, like, it was dealt with seriously, but it wasn't, like, too pessimistic, I think.
All right. Aaron?
I like some of the historical aspects and the costuming and references to history throughout the episode. I kind of think it really did kind of feel like she was traveling through time, and it was kind of a simple way of showing it. We didn't see too much of her past. I kind of wish we'd seen more, maybe, but that probably would have bogged down the episode anyway.
Not to mention, we could have more of those if she appears in further episodes, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there would have been a time where the Kurgan came to kill her husband, and it all would have been awkward.
There can be only one Highlander.
Yeah, my brain was thinking what would be like if she met Duncan MacLeod, but yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be an interesting fight.
Also, the possibility if she shows up later of her having Highlander-esque flashbacks is kind of cool, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's the thing. Do Highlanders have the memory thing that she talks about, how she can only remember so far back and she has to keep
notes? I wouldn't think so, because they're genetically different than regular humans. They're actually intended to be immortal. They weren't made that way after the fact.
Yeah, fact, it pretty much shows otherwise, because they'll have these memory flashbacks to hundreds or hundreds, and in some cases thousands of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, no. All right, whose favorite overall were we at?
I believe we just finished
Aaron's,
so be yours.
Okay, me. So... I had two parts. One, I loved the little throw-out references to both classic and New Who in this episode at various points.
Oh, yeah, I caught some of those, too.
And two, it is actually a Doctor Who tradition to point out the fact that immortality sucks. I think I mentioned this last week. It goes back to the Five Doctors, that immortality is more curse than blessing. And here we see the side effects of immortality and what it does. And the fact that it makes you stop caring. And I really enjoyed that portion of it, too. I know that was also mentioned, but I still kind of like the fact that you get to see, after hearing how much immortality sucks, you actually get to see it. Other than from the mind of the Doctor, who's technically not immortal, just very long-lived.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so things you didn't like. Matt.
Oh. Something you didn't like. I guess this is kind of drawn in for nitpick, but the sidekick, the lion guy, he didn't seem to have a whole heck of a lot of on-screen time. And he seemed fairly superfluous and absolutely useless until, like, the final act where he was trying to escape. And also trying to evade at the same time, apparently.
Who? Which guy?
The lion guy.
Oh, the lion guy, yeah.
Leo, wasn't it?
Leonis or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's clever.
Actually, that's going to be under things I dislike, but...
Leonis.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Tim, what did you dislike?
I question the timing of this episode to, like, have Isildur be brought back the very next episode is one thing. Because I keep thinking about Chekhov's gun, and Chekhov, the rule states that if you have a gun on the fireplace, you don't fire it right away in... it says the gun has to go off in Chapter 4, not Chapter 2.
Yeah, I actually agree with you on this. We know the fact that there was two-parters before the end, or there's another one-parter. I would have taken one of those episodes, strung it earlier if I could, and actually had this be, like, right before the series finale. Mm-hmm. Or done it next season. Or something, instead of making them two feeding off each other like this, because it does make it feel like a two-parter instead of the two one-parters it should have been.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, that's why I didn't give a rating last week, because I thought it was a two-parter.
Something a little bit more like either The Long Game compared to Bad Wolf, or a little bit more like World War III compared to Boomtown.
World War III.
Except each of those involves a two-parter, and obviously we're talking about two single-parters here.
Well, the World War III technically was, but Boomtown was a one-parter, kind of an epilogue to World War III in a way. But they did wait until later in the season to do it.
Right.
Here you had something and a sequel something. My only guess is that all the other episodes related to each other had to be shown in a certain order, so this was the only available slot. Isildur might be showing up in the finale, meaning they had to establish her repeated presence before this.
That's what I was going to say, is that if she appears in the finale in some sort of role, then that'll tie this all in together and make sense why they wanted to, you know, bang her in to two independent slots right up front.
Still,
so she's strong in your mind by the time that comes around.
Still, I would have probably done it if I was Moffat then. I would have done Magista's Apprentice, the witch is, familiar, the first part of this.
Mm-hmm.
And then Under the Lake, Before the Flood, and then the second part of it, just to break them up a little.
Right, yeah. I agree.
You can fill in the gaps between multi-parters.
All right. Bill.
I'm going to say my least favorite thing, and this also goes in the nitpick category, is that between the references to Captain Jack and the Torchwood-esque ideology, it really feels like it's missing John Barrowman. Like, he really should just show up. But if he's a surprise in the finale, I take that back.
Okay,
but as of now, that's my nitpick.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would love to see John Barrowman return. We know that Arrow has basically said, yeah, anytime you need to film Doctor Who, John, just let us know and we'll schedule our filmings around it.
Or even if, especially if the Christmas special turns out to be the Doctor shows up and River Song is helping Torchwood and a Shielder is also there, then that, of course, would...
It'd be one huge cluster altogether.
Oh, yeah. God. No, I'm just seeing this, you know, season finale, Doctor loses Clara, we don't know how. He's in that David Tennant depressive state.
Right.
He opens the door, and standing there is a trio of River Song, Captain Jack, and a Shielder going, having a bad day? And I could just hear Capaldi going, oh, God.
You could have it worse.
I could actually just see Jack there. Like, I got a text from Madame Vastra that you needed something.
Just having them
especially
all there,
in the
it's like having him kind of quote the Gallifreyan general at that point going, all my nightmares. Oh, okay. How about you, Aaron? What did you not like about this episode?
Well, I'm going to beat on the line, guys, some more, because I actually didn't like his costume. It was kind of weird.
Some of his costume was kind of cheap, yeah.
Yeah, it looked like it didn't quite fit right. There was some strange aspect where if you saw it from the side, the snout looked longer than if you were looking at it head on. When you looked at it head on, it looked like it was a little bit closer to his face, to the actor's face.
Mm.
So it looked shorter. It looked more snubby. Mm. Kind of almost like it kind of reminded me of the people who had painted their faces for the Cats musical I went and saw years and years ago.
I like Cats.
I like Cats too, but
I like Cats 3.
It looked like they used two different masks almost, or at least two different snouts from it. Or, I mean, I know things look obviously from perspective. Things are going to look longer when you see them from the side, and they're even longer when you look at them diagonally from any other direction. But yeah, it just, it also seemed very stiff. And again, the muzzle was the big thing. And then also the eyes glowing in the dark, looked really kind of cheesy. Like almost as if computer graphics instead of actual, you know, lights in the eyes.
Oh, look at this scary gif. Oh no.
And then, of course, you've got these glowing eyes. How can no one else see these menacing glowing eyes in the background? They're so, like, shockingly bright. You know, if they were just mere glints or something like that, it would have been more interesting, more intriguing. Almost like, you know, if you've seen, like, a little bit of barely... Like, if they were more animalistic looking.
If they looked like actual cat's eyes.
Yeah, if they look like actual cat's eyes glowing in the dark, you know, with maybe some glass, or maybe if they had the luminescent eyes that cats naturally have from the reflection on the retina, if you had found a way to mimic that, that would have been really cool.
Actually, those are all easily mimicable because they got contacts that do all of that.
Yeah.
Exactly. They could have had so much better.
And instead, it's like they looked at it and said, okay, they looked at it in post and went, oh, yeah, we should have done this, so let's quickly graphic it up.
Let's add an animated GIF and we'll get this done there.
Yeah, the whole lion dude just seemed, well, and of course, you can always say, oh, well, he's an alien. He's like, well, he's an alien that's based on a lion.
Obviously, some sort of cat, at least.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to join in on Aaron's bashing here because. It's really cheesy to take a character based on a cat and have to name him Leandro and come from, where'd they say he was from?
They said he was from another dimension, actually, or something to that effect.
Because he looks at it and mentions a name that also is
it's like Leonin 3 or something like that.
Oh,
it's,
God.
Yeah, that's terrible. It's just overly cheesy, overly childish writing.
What?
And we're supposed to take
inspire?
This guy seriously. Spec this guy. He would have been better replaced with a Dalek.
What? Why does he breathe fire, by the way? I mean, other than
no
the
reason.
Fact that, you know, he's just...
Don't all cats do that?
Well, his
know,
species is Leonian.
Yeah.
I'm looking
where
the planet is from. Delta Leonis.
See? It's horrible. Now, the thing is...
So, basically,
he's
Lion Guy from Lion Species from Lion Planet.
Yeah, it's absolutely horrible, horrible writing in that aspect. Now, if, you know, his name was something unpronounceable and she looked and said, I call him Leo, I could buy that.
Yeah.
Even if, and this still would have been cringeworthy, but even if, like, his planet was named, like, Felicis Delta or something, it still would have been better.
Yeah, at least it's changing up the. At least it's trying to change up the animal references.
It's like the cat people from Star Trek, who are named Kaitians, C-A-I-T. Although that does seem to be the human name for them, so I take that. But they're also from 15 Lincus, according to most of the publications. And I'm like, seriously? I think they finally changed that in official publications to just make it Kite, but that was kind of...
That's like, I lost a lot of respect for the writers of Tales of the Jedi when I realized that Kathar, the cat people, have cat right there in the name. And of course, like, I didn't realize that when I was 8 reading the comics, but looking back on it in the Old Republic, I'm like, Kathar, oh...
Yeah, it's you lose some respect there, and it's again, you know, it's like saying the fact that, you know, you have a race of canid people, dog people, and they just happen to be in a planet orbiting the dog star.
Or you have
fish
people called the Mon Calamari.
Yeah, it's let's talk about the name Mon Calamari and have them be fish people. Okay,
which
Lucas,
might be
Luke,
why
Luke.
In the Clone Wars they started calling them Mon Cala instead, which
that annoyed
me anyway because they were trying to change it retroactively, but still.
Yeah.
I actually prefer that simply because of the fact that it was a bad choice by George Lucas and he had that kind of issues. But
although
now
still better than some of the names that people were given in the credits, like Walrus Face and Squid Man.
Well, still, those are names that, you know, they just gave idly because they didn't actually have an official name for them. But
lazy.
Still, that was kind of, it's, to have that kind of thing, that kind of naming scheme go on, it's kind of annoying.
Might add a little bit more on topic here with this Leo guy. His outfit. Why is he dressed like that? First of all, the animal skin cape. Why?
Why not?
Just pointless is why. Why not? He seems to have almost, I would describe as barbarian attire. So he's a couple centuries off already.
It's space barbarians.
And he's got, yeah, in order to make it spacey, they added ribbits to it. Eh.
Actually, no, those actually did go on some armors like that. Mm. It's pretty much just space barbarians.
It just kind of screams meh. If they're going to go with the space theme, they should have added a little more touch of space to it. And
I mean,
seriously
if they're going to make him dress like freaking Lion-O's father, you know, it just
Just update the armor a bit.
All right, let's move on to actual scenes you liked.
Scenes we liked.
Single scene, Matt. What scene did you like the most out of all of this?
I guess one of the things I liked was some of the banter. To specify which one of the banters, I guess. I guess I kind of liked the banter they were having as they were, in particular when they were going up the chimney.
Okay.
When they were trying to escape. That was some banter that started to hit home for the Doctor in particular, I think.
Okay. As much as the Doctor is opposed to banter, he seems to do it a lot.
Yes. especially with
it's,
someone
it's one
he
of
knows.
His superpowers. It's like Superman being opposed to strength.
Yes, but you know, to spoil another scene in here. There's a point where he goes, "We're bantering. I'm against bantering. It's on record."
Yes, and that was referencing
Robin Hood
episode. Yeah.
All right, so Tim, what's your favorite scene?
My favorite scene is the scene where they're trying to sneak past the sleeping guy on the couch.
So just before mine.
Yeah.
That scene reminded me of something out of an Assassin's Creed game. It actually did.
Mm-hmm. Or
I'm
like
pretty sure I'm pretty sure I had to do something like that in like a Unity or something.
Then slipped into a Laurel and Hardy skit by the end.
Yeah, that's why I love it. I'm a big fan of Stan and Ollie.
All right. Bill, your favorite scene.
Yeah. I'm going to go with the scene where they're looking at the diaries.
Mm.
That was also my number two.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Aaron?
Kind of similar to the diary scene. I like the one where she's describing how, you know, after about 10,000 hours, you're a master at something. After 100,000 hours, you're the best there ever was. I've always kind of dreamed about having that much time to be able to hone my skills, so. I just thought, you know, yeah, it's arrogant sounding, and she's being kind of braggy about it, but at the same time, it's just like, oh man, I really wish I had the time to do that.
All right. Yeah, I really liked that scene, too, because, again, it's kind of pointing out, you know, how longly boring immortality is.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, my favorite scene, I think, is the gallows scene. Where they're
also
taking up, and he starts cracking, you know, cracking jokes into him to impress the crowd. And then the doctor shows up, and he just throws at the doctor desperately, and the doctor blinks for, like, 5 seconds before picking it up.
Mm-hmm. That's one of my favorites, too.
I didn't initially like that character, but I grew to really like him, too. I'm actually hoping he did get immortality and will show up in later episodes,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, he quickly grows on you after that first scene.
Like a fungus, actually.
Something like that.
Like moss on a tree, you take a liking to him.
Oh, Tim. That was punny.
I'm pretty sure the doctor had a stance on puns as well. I'm pretty sure he said line in the sand. Actually.
All right. So, scene you didn't like.
Oh. I'm trying to think of any particular scene I really didn't care for. It seemed kind of pointless for her to go back to her. Just trying to think of something that's generally pointless. Why did she have to run out to Lion Guy and go, oh, by the way, I'm going to be going out in like 10 minutes to continue. We almost got it, but I got help now. So we're definitely going to get this time.
I think because he was expecting her to come back that night with the device.
Mm.
And instead she comes back with the doctor.
Mm-hmm. Age-old story of bringing home the doctor instead of what you meant to rob.
All right, Tim, how about you?
The scene with Lady Mi's blind deaf servant seemed rather underwhelming to me.
Well, I guess their whole concept was that they were planning on using him for the death.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only reason she kept him around. But still, yeah, he was just kind of a waste of a character.
Yeah, he didn't really have enough time to be a character at all on screen. He just has these weird quirks, and he has maybe a grand total of 2-3 lines. just kind of meh.
Yeah.
All right, Bill.
Let's see. I had the resolution felt kind of rushed. It went from yes, I'm going to absolutely do this now because it's the thing that I plan to do, to 2 seconds later, oh my God, this was a bad idea, to all of a sudden, yeah. I'm good again.
Yeah.
I've gone good and don't need to murder people.
It could have used another 30 seconds to a minute there of her watching this slaughter. And just you watch as that callous indifference just melts slowly.
Or even like a scene where like the doctor, you know, like the doctor's like, you know, you realize this is because of you, and she shows some remorse, and then they start to get on well, rather than, okay, you killed the guy, and then you showed, you know, your facial expression shows that you feel bad about it. Now we're going to be best friends. Mm-hmm. Felt like there was a step missing of mm-hmm. some sort.
All right. Aaron?
I'm going to say the glowing eyes scene. That just really... It irked me more than it breathing fire. Like, I could buy alien cat person breathing fire, kind of, sort of. Although I'd rather see it more as a dragon if you're going to try pulling that. Have it be a dragon creature.
There's not enough dragon creatures.
Yeah, it would also tie into the previous episode a lot more. It would explain her connection to it.
Speaking of glowing eyes, when the doctor said, "What's behind the large kitty door?" and the door opens, did anyone else hear a voice say Zool?
Yeah.
It was fairly cheesetastic, was it not?
Again, it could be that they wanted this stuff to be cheesy, but there's well-placed cheese and there's badly done cheese.
Yeah, and with a story that had so many really good and really serious parts, to suddenly force a jerk into the cheese, just ugh, no.
Yeah, you were going between the fine line of the tragedy and the cheese was not good. I think. Considering the fact that my least favorite scenes were taken, I have to go to the scene with the two guys that arrest the doctor in her place, because they serve functionally no purpose.
Because they're so easily swayed.
Yes, they're so easily bribed. The only purpose they are in was to waylay the doctor by, like, a minute and a half. Which, like I said, that time could have been used elsewhere, like in the finale, to extend it.
Mm-hmm.
It just seemed to be kind of
well. You see, there's a quota. If the doctor doesn't get captured a certain number of times every time he lands on Earth, then he has to pay a fine.
Didn't that used to be the companion's job?
I think it was both.
Both.
They tend to get captured so that they can be separated and.
Because I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure Eddie Izzard used to have a running joke about. Doctor Who companions getting captured.
Didn't he also have a running joke about their music, too?
Back in the day? I don't remember. I just remember the... Doctor, I got captured. Saves them again. Thank you for saving me. Oh, I'm captured again. You know?
I imagine I've been captured. I appear to be captured.
So yeah, I just remember that bit.
I'm going through New Who at least. I'm like, before Rose ever gets captured, I think the Doctor gets captured at least twice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, mind you, these comments were I think before New Who. This was Classic Who.
Right.
Yeah.
So my comment was, well, wasn't that the companion's job? When did it become the Doctor's? Apparently, somewhere in that.
Another part of my brain is thinking back to Frontier in Space when they were taking turns.
Yeah, that was tag team getting captured. Didn't I actually refer to that one as getting captured, the serial?
Quite possibly.
Because that's kind of what it felt like.
That happens once in a while in Doctor Who.
No, I think I referred to Dalek Master Plan as getting captured, the serial.
Oh, yeah. God.
Considering we watched Frontier in Space not long after that, I think I actually considered that a break from getting captured. So, my least... Okay, I did my least favorite scene. We've got a few minutes to discuss here. We actually ran ahead on the favorites and least favorites, so...
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, we didn't shoehorn around this time. Yay.
No. So... Should this episode have been a two-part story or two separate one-part stories as they were written as? Your opinions, guys.
They should have held off on bringing Isildur back. They should have, in my opinion, or basically, I'm just saying that's what I would have done. If
yeah, I mean, it may be good if they had done. Girl who died, Zygons, woman who lived, you know, maybe a reason why Clara couldn't come with him that day and he was going off on his own, woman who lived, next two-parter, and then whatever this third act is going to be, because the ending of this episode clearly hints that there's some sort of third act, whether it's going to be this season or next season. Actually, knowing Moffat, it might be in two seasons from now, but I hope it's this season.
Well, we don't know because Moffat doesn't know if he's going to be writing two seasons from now.
Yeah,
true.
That's just
I think part of Moffat's issue is he's not master planning anymore, and actually, that's turning out to be a good thing.
Because he can't do master plans.
Yeah, because he's taking it a season at a time now, and he doesn't want to leave with a whole bunch of loose ends. So he's wrapping up all of his loose ends within a season instead of leaving stuff hanging for seasons at a time. Because remember, we had the whole name of the doctor thing hanging over our heads for a good chunk of a season, and the whole Silence Will Fall thing, started at the beginning of Series 6 and didn't get resolved until,
end of finale. Series 7.
Until not even the end of Series 7, until
the Christmas special, which is
yeah.
You know, I just realized though, we've gone two episodes without any premonition of the Doctor's death.
Oh,
very true.
You're right.
Yes,
That must be a new record.
We broke the streak because, yeah, it's like every episode, the Doctor's going to die, the Doctor's going to die, the Doctor's celebrating his death. And now we're actually seeing the Doctor just living. Hey, there's a thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I would do if I was going to die.
I do love the fact that the last episode they addressed the face thing, and this episode they started throwing out the references because, you know... It's feeling like Moffat's taking a step back from his master planning and going, oh yeah, there's all this stuff from other seasons we could use. Hey, let's talk about Captain Jack. We haven't
speaking of which, that's right. I remarked while I was watching this, the Visitation, which is, by the way, which might be irrelevant. It wouldn't otherwise be relevant, but considering the discussions going on. The last episode in which the 70s, 80s sonic screwdriver was ever seen, in addition to the Doctor being involved in the starting of the Fire of London. And that was, that was referenced here explicitly because they say the word pteroleptals.
Yes, they do. That was actually the end of the Visitation, was the lab blowing up, starting the Great Fire of London.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So, that was the pteroleptals were the one that destroyed the Fifth Doctor's sonic screwdriver.
Yep.
And unlike New Who, where he just then proceeds to go and get another one made for him, he decided to save the world with kettle and string.
Oh, by the way, speaking of sonics, no Sonic this episode.
Yes, there was.
He used the glasses.
To light a candle of all of all stupid things.
Yeah, I guess it was just that one time use.
I could buy highly technological sunglasses lighting a candle as long as you don't call them Sonic.
Yeah, I, well, the thing is, though, I saw him pull out the glasses and do it, and I was like, oh. Because I really hoped them getting smashed last episode was the end of the Sonic sunglasses. I'd honestly hoped he'd go back to using a freaking screwdriver after that. But no.
Apparently not.
Could go back to the first Doctor where he lost his matches and they spend a serial trapped on Earth, or on a planet because he lost his matches.
Oh, shoot us.
That's the plot device that started Doctor Who.
Yes. And then of course, wandering around a Dalek world because he spilled some mercury deliberately and had to go look for more. Yes, once again, we're mentioning the first Doctor in his early season was a dick.
He was during that first couple of episodes, yeah.
Right. Well, it's close enough to 45, so let's start up with our final thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
And let's start with you, Matt.
Okie doke. So, final thoughts. It does feel like this one trails up a little too close behind the last episode to not be a two-parter. And our main antagonist hardly gets any on-screen time, and when he does get on-screen time, he's a little bit disappointing. That being said, however, there's a lot of really good things. The new background for, what was it? She called herself Me in this one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The slowly developing background for Me, her nice library of her personal history to remind herself what she really needs to remember. And the lessons she's also hopefully permanently learned from the Doctor in this particular one will hopefully stay with her for a while. The whole, she wants to get off Earth, but she suddenly realizes that she doesn't want it that desperately, that she would cause so much harm and damage. Also not to mention the fact that she was betrayed, so she has kind of learned that, not to blindly trust just anybody, he'll help her get off the planet. She's also decided to devote herself to following the, other companions of the Doctor, so that should be an interesting background story to come up with. There's a lot of really good other things going on other than the main ending, sadly. But there's a lot of really good stuff that still comes out of even that. So I'd say it's a mishmash, but there's a lot of overwhelmingly good things compared to the letdowns.
All right. Tim?
I think this was a worthy follow-up to The Girl Who Died. Even if it did come too soon, I don't think it was as good as The Girl Who Died. I liked the pacing and just the characterization of the first episode better.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the villain character and some of the side characters could have been handled better. Or like just handled, period. instead of just like sticking them in there because we need filler and we need someone for the Doctor to talk to. And I thought this ended on a very good cliffhanger. When the Doctor's looking at the selfie, because it sort of like really hints that there's more to come, but it's not so overwhelming that you have to know, you're demanding to know right away. You know, like, it whets your appetite so you can, like, be satisfied with that for a bit. And I think that's well done. So those are my thoughts.
All right. Bill?
I'm going to say, very interesting episode. As I've somewhat referenced before, the tone feels very much along the lines of almost being Torchwood, obviously without the sex and the violence and the drugs. But, you know, take those things out. It's a bit more Torchwood than Doctor Who with, you know, what's left of it. Between Ashielder's references to other things and just the general what the episode's about. The supporting characters are definitely a bit weaker. They weren't entirely the point. I think it was still a pretty successful episode. And by the way, since I didn't mention it before, considering the era, I'm kind of wondering if Ashielder met the Queen after the Doctor married her and flew away. would give some credence to some of the information she's picked up.
Yeah, especially as me, she seems to be pretty well off, so I wouldn't be surprised if she might be almost considered somewhere along the lines of nobility. And she was previously a queen, princess.
They referred to her as Lady Me, so that does seem to...
Yeah, she does seem to be of nobility.
So she is nobility of some sort.
Interesting.
All right, so whose final thoughts were we on?
Aaron's next.
Aaron, okay. All right.
Well, I thought this episode was pretty good, like I said, from the historical aspects. I did not think that the alien played out very well at all. It probably shouldn't have even been in this episode. I would have rather had, or if it was, it should have had a stronger tie to the previous one. Like I said, maybe taking the form of a dragon or something. I would have liked them see them fight maybe the person that Ashielder had given the second chip to. Maybe that person had gone bad, or that person had to find the Doctor to stop Ashielder or something like that. Play off the second chip a little bit more. Instead of, it felt like it was just kind of a waste giving it to Sam the Swift, or, you know, however likable that character is. So, I don't know. I think there was a lot of wasted opportunities in this episode.
All right. Well, this episode was written by Catherine Shigenna, who's known for her Torchwood writing. She wrote several of...
I forgot about that. Good point.
Some of the better Torchwood episodes, including Captain Jack Harkness, Meat, which is one where they're killing an alien and eating the meat constantly because it's a regenerator. She's known for that kind of writing. And this does seem to have that kind of air about it. There are a lot of issues with this episode, largely the relatively weak bad guy who doesn't show up a lot and is very cliche in his, "Ha, I'm betraying you to attack the planet," and his basic air. It's like you knew he was a bad guy from the beginning, and the only one that couldn't seem to figure that out was Ashielder, so... I kind of thought that was a bit of a letdown. Its scheduling area is kind of questionable. There should have been some feeling of time passing an adventure between. So you had the feeling that for the Doctor time passed, which it obviously had. But the actual acting portrayals by both the main and guest cast is pretty top-notch and is the only thing saving this from being a subpar episode.
Mm-hmm.
And now, the ratings. Oh. We start with you, Matt.
Back to me again.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, it's a little bit of a mixed bag, but it is overwhelmingly mostly positive, in my opinion. So I can't go too low. But it's not as good as the previous one. I believe the previous one I gave a 4-2, so I'd have to give this... Yeah, so I have to give this... it'd be probably just low enough to round down, so I'll give it a 3.5.
3.5 from the mat. Tim.
Like I said, I also think this was not as good as the previous one, and since I gave the previous one 5, I'm going to give this one 4.5.
Tim being generous again. Bill.
I'm a nice guy.
I'm going to give this another 4, as I guess I'm in the minority and considering it to be around the same level as the previous episode in terms of all around.
Aaron.
Now, the previous one just barely skidded by with a 4.0 from me, but this one, I think there's enough flaws in it. I'm going to knock it down to a 3.0.
And I am with Aaron on this. I gave the last one a 3.5. This one is not as good. The only thing saving it from being in the twos is the acting. So it'll average out to a 3 flat. And that gives our average as 3.6.
I was closest.
Well, we have Tim over there skewing our voting.
Ha ha ha. Ha 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 ha. Ha ha ha.
Okay, I'm sorry. We have Mandark over there skewing our vote.
That evil laugh.
Because that was a Mandark laugh. That was pretty much right out of the Dexter's Lab book.
Yep. Yeah. Good for you.
You know, I actually saw that guy on a an old Spielberg movie, 1941. And he actually sounds like that. It was kind of hard for me to watch.
Because the entire time you're watching, you're seeing Mandark.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good one. What is the lowest score I've ever given something?
Let's see. This season, your lowest score has been 4.5. Last season...
You did give a 1.0 to Torchwood Cyberwoman.
Okay.
Yeah, that was worth it. You were actually the lowest scorer there because everyone else gave it at least a 1.5, and you, Matt, gave it a 2.
Oh.
Being Captain Generous. Were you with us when we reviewed Journey? I don't think so.
I don't think he was, no.
Nope, he hadn't joined us yet.
Journey, of course, being our permanent basement dweller.
It will only get shoved deeper.
Yeah, it just keeps dropping down the ratings as...
It is as low as we have number of episodes.
I think it's interesting that the one time I gave a low score was I was the lowest. So it seems I'm always the guy who goes against the grain.
I'm not sure why I give that a 2. Maybe I was being too nice that day or something.
So out of, at this point, out of 125 episodes reviewed, The Woman Who Lived comes in at number 100.
Oh.
It comes up just above Voyage of the Damned.
Oh.
And just below Destiny of the Doctor, Enemy Aliens, and it rates the same as Destiny of the Doctor, Enemy Aliens, and The Crimson Horror, an episode we pretty much despised from Series 7, if I recall.
The majority of us despised, yeah.
It's on the same ranking as Revenge of the Cybermen, and somehow rates the same rating as... Wait a minute, this can't be right. This can't be right. Hold on a minute. Something's not tracking. None of us... No, this should be a 3.0. Why is this rating a 2.8? Something's not recording right. So let me manually go to the 3.6s. It would actually be number 46 in our listings between Ghostlight and A Town Called Mercy.
Oh. That's better.
Or wait, actually... 3.6 should be number, I'm sorry, it'll be in the mid-60s, around the Daleks, Resurrection of the Daleks, Tomb of the Cybermen, Town Called Mercy, in that zone.
That's not bad zone.
Yeah, the low 60s to 70s, somewhere in there.
I need to figure out...
What didn't get recorded right? Something didn't get recorded right.
What did you say is coming up as a 2.8?
Hang on, I think I know what's went wrong, so.
Okay.
One of these numbers isn't right, Cordy, right?
Yeah, okay, I got it. I see what went wrong. Anyway, that's where it's going to wind up. I think Tim's question on what did he vote lowest threw me off, and I forgot to change a couple of fields.
I'm sorry.
But already, I think it's time, Bill.
Yep. Go ahead and close us out.
If you enjoy listening to our episodes, please consider liking our videos and subscribing on YouTube, Twitch, and Mixcloud. You can also like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter for news and updates. If you want to support us, you can go on over to patreon.com/unearthlypodcast and choose from the rewards there. Of course, do not forget to join us next week as we take a look at The Zygon Invasion by Peter Harness. And answer, of course, the question on everyone's minds, why is Osgood here?
Why is she here? Why are any of us here? Where am I? Who are you? Who am I?
Me? I'm on a boat. Look at me. Now look at your friend. Now look at me.
I have an oyster. Ow, on my nose.
See you next week, people.
Ciao.
Good night.